Good evening, everyone. PAWrestling.com's Match of the Week. We're here at Owen J. Roberts High School as the Wildcats host the Springford Rams in a battle for second place in the Pac-10. Sitting in with Mike and I tonight is Chuck Nestle, former Owen J. wrestler, current Owen J. teacher, and Springford football coach. So he's going to bring some insight from known kids from both programs. Chuck, welcome to PA Wrestling. Thanks for sitting with us tonight.
Yeah, thanks for having me. It's going to be a good match here. Both teams have some good wrestlers. I'm looking forward to it. Looking forward to having some fun with you.
Thanks. We're starting off tonight at 182 pounds. Already checking at the table for the Wildcats is Nick Douliakis. Nick Douliakis is a junior. Comes in with a record of 9-7. And this for this season has an eighth place at Escape the Rock to his credit.
Douliakis is a wrestler, played some D-line for O&J this year. Pretty fit-looking kid.
Nice shove there, pass off the elbow, getting in on the double leg, takes him down to the mat. Douliakis is wrestling Chase Smith from Springford. He's a freshman, comes in a record of 2-1. Douliakis doing a good job getting pressure for his working the 2-on-1. We'll see if he's going to hit that patented Wildcat roll. He's looking to cinch it up a little bit more, get a little bit tighter, and see if Smith will come up off his belly. There it is. He runs his feet around. Better watch it. Our official tonight is Kurt Weinberger. He's holding three. There is a hold broken, and there's a 3 out of 2. He runs his lead to 5-0 with 57 seconds left in the first period.
Dooley's had control here for the first period. It's going to be a close match here. Bonus points are going to be big. I'm sure both sides and both coaches instructed that to their kids. Can't give up bonus points tonight if you want to win the match.
Exactly. You know, and Chuck, as we know, Boyertown's already locked up the league. So, you know, now it's going to be a fight for second place in the league. And, it's just the usual suspects here. You know, Boyertown, O&J, Springford, Boyertown, like I said, haven't already won the league. And there's a lot on the line for this match here tonight.
Yeah, you got bragging rights. You know, they share a border. Both lineups have some strong spots and some weak spots. It's going to be interesting how this plays out here.
Yep, as we have 5 seconds left in the period, looks like Douliakis will end with a 5-0 lead. Springford comes in with a record of 16-3 overall. They're 7-1 in the league. They're 11th at the Cumberland Valley Kickoff Classic earlier in the year, 2nd at the Ghost Town Duels hosted by Abington High School, 5th at the Mannheim Holiday Classic, and they're 3rd at the Rock Yard Duels hosted by Council Rock North. Douliakis takes neutral here in the second period, looking to get on his offense again. Wildcats come with a overall record of 8-3, 4-1 in the league. They have a few matches to make up, Cats, because of weather and whatnot. They are 5th at Beeler Duels at Boyertown earlier this season, 10th at King of the Mountain, 5th at Conestoga Valley Holiday Classic, and 24th at the Escape the Rock tournament.
Both teams wrestling pretty challenging schedules. That's what you want to do if you want to be a top-tier program.
Contrasting, there you go, with another hand pass off or arm pass to a single leg. Douliakis gets a takedown and make it 7-0, but contrast in schedules, two different schools of thought. O&J more with the tournament team, and they have Springford, on the other hand, with the more dual meet laden schedule, still hitting some tough individual tournaments, but, hitting those two dual meet tournaments, gives that, a lot can be said. Is it preparing them more for the postseason? That we're in the midst of right now, both teams in the quarterfinals this Friday of the district duels. So both have daunting tasks in the first round. In the quarterfinal round you have.
Yes,
Springford after beating the Chamois in a good match. Draws Boyertown again, who they lost to last week. And speak of Boyertown, they actually let some Boyertown fans in here tonight to watch. Shout out to John Cooley here tonight with his son and a few other guys from the team, Matt Wild, Elijah Jones.
Some bad haircuts, I tell you.
Oh, man, he did that dye job again. I am looking forward to see if Harvey did indeed dye his mustache. And Mike Leiser confirmed it for me that we'll be seeing Boyertown on Friday Greg Harvey has indeed dyed his mustache. So we've got 35 seconds left in the period here. A lot of hand fighting as Dulac's put him on his feet. There he goes, passes his hand attack. Defense again in a shot, but Smith does a nice job diving down to the legs and trying to funk him here. Funk roll. Dulac's doing a nice job of sticking him right on his back. He's got him in trouble.
This is points at the Wildcats.
There it is.
Yep.
You called it, Chuck. At 3 minutes and 39 seconds, you have, 3 minutes and 41 seconds, you have Dulac is getting the slap of the mat at 182 pounds. Gets the Wildcats off to the right to the start they needed. Coming up now for ONJ, you have senior Xavier Frizzi coming to the record of 2-0. Missed some time earlier this year due to an elbow injury. See it heavily taped there. Nice snap down into a cradle. He's got him dead to rights there.
Yep.
Now he's back in a low leg Turk. He got a takedown and three back. He's going to go far shoulder claw. Nope, he lets him out of the Turk. Wrestling for Springford, we have...
This is Tim Moran.
One of your football players, coach?
He's a junior, 2-16 record.
Frizzy having his way with him right now.
Yeah, Frizzy has a little bit outmanned here. ONJ's got to get points here at the upper weights. It's a nice job by Tim fighting off his back.
Yep, a lot of fight in this kid. We saw him wrestle this past week at against Boyertown. He wrestled and went out and fought. There's no quitting him. Frizzy looking for another set of back as we're at the halfway point of the first period. If Moran gets off his back, it'll be 11-0. And there's the fall at a minute and 5 seconds. Runs the ONJ lead to 12-0. This is where ONJ, or rather Springford, doesn't match up too well with the Wildcats. Next up, we have Connor Mitchell. Is that one of your football players, coach?
Yeah, Coach Connor here, football for a few years, had him in class, awesome kid. Probably going to be able to pick his own school, apply to like North Carolina, Virginia. Really smart kid, hardworking, proud of what he's accomplished and how far he's grown. Was a scrawny little kid in middle school.
We have Zach Gogol, who's a junior from Springford, and he's 4-18 on the season. Again, Connor Mitchell, in our latest rankings, is ranked third in the region. And there's your fall at 34 seconds, 18-0, and the Wildcats are rolling right now up on Springford as we go into heavyweight. We'll see if Springford can stop the bleeding right here. We have Bill Scherfel reporting to the table for the Wildcats. And for Springford, coach, we have?
That's Matt Lepore.
Matt played football at Springford?
Yeah, he's a sophomore, 17-9 record. This should be an interesting match here.
Some say Scherfel's the one-hit wonder.
He likes to throw the headlock, don't he?
He does.
You would have thought he grew up in Upper Perk area, you know?
Yeah, you know, you would think so. But, you know, he does actually have a pretty nice double when he gets into it. He's got some good offense for a big guy. Hard to wrestle for his size at the heavyweight.
That's just a football tackle he's using, you know?
There's a shot attempt at it. He passed his hands, but decide better of it. We've 30 seconds gone here in the first period. Both guys feeling each other out.
Both of these young men are very hardworking, good kids.
Nice crowd here tonight. Home side filled up, wayside just about filled up.
Yeah, all four rows on both sides are full. Probably the smallest gym in the Pac-10, what do you think?
I think so. After Pasco built their new gym, I think we're ONJ is now, fortunately, has the smallest gym. It's even not that bad. They have the bleachers on the one side. But
some Cat Pack members over there in the corner.
Yep. And Bill's attempt at the headlock. Knew we'd see it at least once. I'm sure it's not the last time we see it. We have about 45 seconds left in the first period here. No score. 18-0 lead for the Wildcats of ONJ Roberts. To Scherfel's credit on the year, he is 16-9. He was eighth at Conestoga Valley. He was also eighth at Escape the Rock. Had a real nice tournament to wrestle back to eighth place. And Moran is I'm sorry, not Moran. Yeah, Tim Moran. Oh, no, I'm sorry, Matt Lepore. My fault. Excuse me on that. Lepore is, like you said, a sophomore, 17-9 in the season, 17-10 for his career.
There's your first stalling.
Yeah, you know, Scherfel, he hasn't taken too many good shots, but he's been one on the offensive. Lepore's kind of just holding on.
First period, 0-0. My buddies call the big guys the Dancing Bears.
Yeah.
A lot of dancing. Need to get aggressive.
Yep. Scherfel, middle linebacker for Rich Kolka's Wildcat football team. Had a nice season. Here going to break down. Scherfel getting pressure forward, going right to that crossface cradle. Took Lepore's headgear off. See if he can lock it up. He's got to do a lot of forward pressure to lock a big guy like this. And he's not getting much leg drive. He's on his knees. His best fit now, doing what he's doing, crossface, going, picking the near ankle. Maybe we'll go near leg, near side Turk. 25 seconds gone here in the second period. Still 0-0 match.
Yeah, Bill doesn't have the biggest arm span, so he struggles with some leverage stuff, being a little smaller. He's got to utilize his quickness, strength.
He wrestles to his size very well. He makes a lot of the bigger heavyweights wrestle to his height, which
yes.
I think is why he's as successful as he is.
Yes.
Kurt Weinberg stopped the match as Matt Lepore's headgear came off. Give him a chance to put it on, get restarted here. A couple of those crossfaces that came from Scherfel earlier in the period ripped it off. And there we go, good breakdown by Scherfel. Again, Lepore really hasn't done much even come up out of his base. Part of it is in tune because of pressure at Scherfel's crate. And there we go. Just as I said that.
Good fight out of both of them there.
Yep, as we just crossed the midpoint of the match, still 0-0.
You know, both these teams have kids that got some regional aspirations and possibly some state aspirations here. Both programs got hardworking kids, great coaches.
Yeah, you can't say enough about the coaching staff of these two teams. Your former teammate Aaron Brown coaching here, come back along with Duraflo, Brilla, Willman, Gerber, Sage, your former head coach Sage is still around helping out. And it just goes to show you, it's how you build the program and have the success that you've had. And on the other side, you have longtime coach Tim Sizelov, you know, assisting him now. Tom Hans, his longtime assistant Jason Kirkus, recent resigns, but, you know, he goes out and finds him the top notch assistant. You know, you find, not every day you find a Hall of Famer to come in and be your assistant. So,
yeah.
Kudos to, Coach Sizelov for doing that. 13 seconds left in the second period. Scherfel's done a great job of riding here, not giving anything up, not letting him escape. The stall warning. Say the last 30 seconds, Scherfel didn't get lazy, but stopped on the offensive, rode a little bit too parallel there.
Okay, he's got to get out to the side, make it look like he's working a little more.
Part of a heavyweight wrestling, make you gotta look busy. It's not about actually being busy, it's about looking busy. Sure that ONJ coaching to put Scherfel down. He's already crawling back to the center circle. Get ready for third period here. Escape might be all it takes to win this match.
Lepore's looking a little winded here. Billick can explode off the bottom here. I think it'll be get out here pretty quick.
For a turn seal from Scherfel, and he's out just like that. 3 seconds in the period, he's going for more. And again, we talk about body styles, and not every heavyweight can sit out and turn in like that, like Scherfel's able to, because he's
absolutely
compact.
Yep, a little too quick for Lepore to handle there.
That's the second what you said before. Lepore is looking a little bit tired. He's heavy stepping. Scherfel's looking pretty fresh right now. Ooh, we set him up for a headlock, but didn't get it. Minute 24 left in the match here. 1-0 lead for Bill Scherfel. considering Lepore has not taken a shot attempt yet, that might be all he needs, unless he can somehow coax a stalling point out of Kurt Weinberger here to make it. He got, you know, Scherfel tipped the stall warning towards the end of the, right at the end of the second period. There's a knee slap attempt. Scherfel better watch himself. It's going to come sooner than later.
Yep, they both seem kind of content right now.
Seconds left in the match. Slide by attempt by Lepore. Now he's just pushing. He's trying to set up. He's trying to get the stall call. He's just pushing.
Here's one of these matches if Lepore can squeak this out, can get some momentum on the Rams side.
20 seconds go. Scherfel doing a good job staying in the middle of the mat, not trying to back up, trying to stay in that center circle. Weinberger, a seasoned official, has not seen through the attempts or failed attempts of the slide by Lepore. He knows he's not really trying, but Scherfel better watch himself here. Ooh. 21-0 is the score here, folks. Through four matches, three pins, and a decision for the Wildcats. You turn over to the small guys. One of the marquee matchups tonight, we have Luke Resnick wrestling against Brandon Meredith. In our latest rankings, they rank 1 and 2 in the region at 106 pounds. Meredith being ranked first, coming to record 23-5, and Luke Resnick coming to record 21-4. Right into the underhook goes Meredith. He snaps down, puts the underhook, thinks better of it, backs out. Maybe we'll see a little bit more action out of little guys here.
We better.
Even when there's not a lot of points, there's typically more action.
This is a nice matchup for both of these guys going into the postseason.
Yep.
You know, again, if you want to get to the next level, you want to constantly wrestle good kids.
Yep. Both these guys had, like you talked about, aspirations. Yeah, I think aspirations of getting to Hershey.
Yeah.
And maybe even find themselves on the podium when it's all said and done. Again, Meredith looking to work those hooks. Resnick looking to back out. He's in on both elbows. Got elbow control. In the back out. Meredith has had 23-5 in the season. 34-12 as a freshman. Was a regional qualifier but did not place. He's 57-17 for his career. He was sixth to Cumberland Valley this year and was first at the Mannheim Holiday Tournament.
Lukey Resnick coming in at 21-4. He was 20-15 last year. Been wrestling 106 pounds. He's a little guy. Has grown into the 106 pounds.
I was just going to say, if I'm not mistaken, this is the first year he's actually a true 106 pounder.
Yes.
I think his freshman year was behind his brother, Ryan, who we'll see later on, 138, 106, if memory serves me correct. And then last year he was the guy, and Ryan was at 113. And Ryan hit a little bit of a growth spurt, and so did Luke, and Luke grew into 106, and Ryan grew to a 38 pounder. And there's Luke in on a head inside single. He's driving. Meredith doing a good job of those hooks. Nice job of cracking hips down by Luke. He's come over the top. He might have a low leg cradle locked up. He's having a low leg cradle locked up, but he's getting back.
That was a slick little move there by Luke.
Again, he's cracking the hips down. He was getting countered. It made sense to take it over the head. Two back, jumped out to a 4-0 lead with 5 seconds going to first period here. Not give him anything up to be a huge, huge period. Owen Jay's choice here.
Luke's biggest supporter, big bro.
Yep.
Right here, giving him some words of encouragement.
Not sure if he's older, but he's definitely bigger. There you go, quarter turn, seals it off, but not able to get up. Mara's working, trying to work 2-1. He's going to go low leg Turk here. Try lift and step in. Luke kept his hips away.
Luke's the smarter of the two, by the way.
And they've escaped the run to lead to 5-0. Luke has a very, very slick dump. So he's not afraid to wrestle from this position here because, you know, he likes being under his elbows there. So we'll see if he's able to hit it. A lot of people know it's coming, but he looked to reach in there and hit it. Had no luck. We covered Boyertown O&J, and we covered Springford Boyertown, and Wild beat Resnick. Wild beat Meredith. We'll see what happens right now. So top of the food chain in the Pac-10, it goes Matt Wild from Boyertown. And then we'll see who number two potentially going to stake their claim at two tonight here. Halfway through the match, and it's 5-0 in favor of Luke Resnick from O&J Roberts. The Wildcats lead 21-0 here early goings in our fifth match of the night.
How about that? All three kids, right? Hershey aspirations in the yep. same league, you know?
Yep.
It's a tough way to go, you know?
And that's why I say, not year in and year out, but a lot of years, Pac-10 being one of the toughest, if not the toughest, leagues to wrestle in. It's there's a lot more teams than your traditional, some suburban ones, a large league, but they have their different conferences within it. Pac-10 is 10 teams, soon to be 12 starting next season with the addition of Norristown and Upper Marion. But a lot of times the league tournament is a precursor for what's going to happen at the higher level. Resnick now circling out after being reversed, or taken down rather, and he's trying to hit the dump with 9 seconds to go. He's going, you see him going. He's coming around, he's got him. Oh, Meriton, a great job. Thought Resnick had him. He tries to hit it again and sit through, almost had it. O&J bench up in arms.
Coach is not happy over here.
Thought he should add your former teammate, Aaron Brown. I think we might be lucky that Mike's not closer to the bench. Merritt takes bottom to start the third period. Resnick looking to break him off his base. 5-2 lead he has here at the start of the third.
I could read Coach Brown's lips on that one. I'm pretty sure he wasn't sharing a recipe with the ref. Pretty fired up over here.
They all were.
Yeah.
Minute 30 left. Meredith trying to come up. Resnick drives down and wisely lets him go. 5-3. So Meredith's going to have to get on his offense here. He needs a takedown to tie. Takedown and maybe more. I don't think you're going to see Resnick back down, though. He's not going to shut it down.
Got the Wild kid in the stands, maybe doing a little extra scouting for the postseason here, getting a look at both of these boys. You got to love the competition in the league and the way the kids compete against each other.
And in most cases, these kids have competed against each other for years.
Yeah.
And as much as they are rivals on the mat, all these kids are friends off the mat. The way they talk with one another and hang out after the match. A lot of mutual respect here between these teams. Boyertown, O&J, Pottstown, Springford. These guys have unbelievable amount of respect for each other's programs and as wrestlers. 35 seconds to go here. Meredith with a snap down. Resnick right to the elbow. He's in on the outside. He's got an outside single. Just reached up high. Not really committing to it. He's the same time that elbow, so he can't get around. Meredith trying to spin behind. Resnick doing a good job. He's still in the elbow. And there's the takedown with 18 seconds to go.
He just didn't quit. Can't let up.
He can't ride that ankle like that. Resnick's in trouble. Tries a Granby. Ill-advised Granby. He's got a fight just not to get turned. And we are going to overtime here. For you folks who are not familiar, we're going to go first takedown wins here in this minute period. If no takedown happens, we'll go to a coin toss for two mandatory 30-second rideouts. It's still tied after that. First point score, which goes to Resnick, will have a choice, top or bottom, for ultimate rideout. Up. Meredith with the shot, tried to sneak underneath. Resnick with the counter. He's trying to step over. Meredith's not out of it yet. He's got two hands on it. He's coming out the back. Resnick staying in on the hips. See if we get a stalemate here. Nothing yet. Nothing yet. He's got to hook those feet. He's turned back to the head. Resnick back up. Great scramble here. Nothing yet. Nothing yet. There's your two. Huge, huge turn of events here for the Rams. Makes it 21-3. Resnick has to be disappointed with himself. 4-0 lead to lose 7-5.
Awesome match there by both gentlemen.
Definitely. Match that I had on paper is one of the swing matches that was going to help build momentum going either way. We have Dirk Nugent from Springford and Tyler McCutcheon, first of the two McCutcheon brothers from O&J Roberts.
This Dirk Nugent kid's a freshman, wrestled really well. You mentioned last week when they wrestled Boyertown, his father's the principal at the high school, former coach.
He was a coach in your high school, right?
He was a coach at Springfield Ride. He was the opposing coach when I came through O&J here. Tremendous family, you know, tremendous work ethic.
Yep.
Expecting big things out of him this year and years to come.
Sam McCutcheon comes in with a record. There he is with a takedown. Tyler McCutcheon comes in with a record of 8-9 on the season. 8-12 for his career. He was sixth at Cumberland Valley, or I'm sorry, Conestoga Valley over the holiday break.
Dirk Nugent's 18-5 coming into tonight.
2-0 lead early, a minute and 10 left in the first period. Had opportunity to speak with Nugent's father before the Boyertown Springfield match, and he was satisfied and very proud of his son for the confidence thus far, and very tight-lipped as far as how he thought he was doing. He didn't want to give the coach's opinion, gave the fatherly opinion, which was pleasant to hear. So
this Tyler McCutcheon kid's a tough kid. He's been smaller his whole life, starting to grow into his body a little bit here. He's a tough kid. Had him in class last year. Works hard, smart. This should be a good match as well.
Yep. Come down 30 seconds to go here in the first period. McCutcheon, again, a guy, like you said, kind of guy always behind the Resnicks. And, finally found his spot in the lineup. And it's nice to see because, again, like you said, very hard worker. Good in the room. 20 seconds left in the period here. 21-3 lead for the Wildcats off the, they won the first four matches. And then Springford, Brandon Merritt was able to stop the bleeding, getting decision from over Luke Resnick. Going back to that Resnick-Merritt match, that match wrestled 10 times. It's going to go 5-5. I think the same goes for Matty Wild and either of those guys, Wild and Meredith and Wild and Resnick and Wild and so on and so forth. You wrestle them 10 times, they're going to split it 5-5. They're so evenly matched. They know each other so well. Nice grabby attempt by Nugent at the buzzer, but does not get it. McCutcheon was up to the task to counter that.
Right, can't lose focus for 1 second. You're right, all three of those kids, good wrestlers. Goes down, it's probably going to go down to the wire all postseason with those three. Really looking forward to the Pac-10 tournament, district tournament at Springford. They always do a nice job at Boyertown and Springford, hosting those two postseason tournaments.
Definitely very hospitable schools, and just have the experience running a tournament, running a big event. And that's a testament to the volunteers and from the Boyertown Area Wrestling Association and from the Springford youth program, their high school, their middle school, their parents. It's a whole community thing. It's not just one team. It's the community comes out and rallies to get these tournaments.
Absolutely.
And big events hosted.
Takes an army, You need volunteers.
Exactly.
Need support from all angles.
There you go. McCutcheon on the counter of the shot. A poor shot by Nugent. Sam McCutcheon's a sophomore. Tyler Ricky coming up as a freshman. Be coming out either 45 or 52. I think when they were younger, I think Ricky kept Tyler from the dinner table, maybe. Just under past the midway point of this match, it's a 4-0 lead for Tyler McCutcheon off two takedowns. One in the first period, one in the second period. He rose Britton and be able to ride Nugent pretty tough here from the top position, but unable to turn him. Nugent with the sit-out turn-in, and he's able to get the reversal. See how he does on top here for the first time. It's interesting because, as you know, coming through O&J and coming through the Pac-10, you know, knowing what for years was the bread and butter of Springford, the wing series. And there's a sit-out turn and escape by McCutcheon. Now they bring Tommy Hansen to the fold. And, you know, again, you know what's coming on top when he's the coach, the vaunted cross-face cradle that he made.
Seeing a lot of cradles.
Exactly.
Doing cradles, watching JV matches. They were all doing cradles.
Yep. You know, we actually talked about that. We would be surprised. We would be not surprised whatsoever to see a few headlocks and or cross-face cradles come out of these Springford guys. We're in the third period here. It's 5-2 lead for Tyler McCutcheon. And I said this is one of the swing matches. This one is, let's say, you know, come up at 138, Ryan Resnick and Matt Kriebel is a match that's a marquee matchup here for the region as far as rankings go and in the Pac-10. Nice job by Nugent. Good, a lot of good movement on bottom. Just didn't string that third move together. Sat out, turn in. McCutcheon spun around the front. Real nice top job on top. But probably really going to try not to give up two like he did last time. If anything, he'll look to give up one before two. Nugent did a good job creating space for himself by taking up over the top. McCutcheon hold on to the ankle. He's got to come up. He can't lay there. He's got to get a little bit hip height. Nugent come out the back door, a little funk roll. Now McCutcheon can come up with it.
This is a big match for both sides here.
Exactly.
Springport's got some veterans coming up, some older seniors. Wildcats have a couple younger guys coming up the next couple matches.
McCutcheon doing a good job staying composed there. Nugent, again, for a freshman, as cool as can be, and, you know, wrestling a tough match here. He's not out of it yet. We have a minute left. There's a reversal. 5-4 match. This is what I was saying about it.
McCutcheon's got to be careful. You don't get turned here.
I heard that Coach Pat Nugent and Dirk were practicing that move last night in the basement. My sources tell me. We go here, come over top of him, crossface cradle, breaks McCutcheon back down. I think McCutcheon going to get hit with a stall call here real soon.
Coach wanted to cut him.
Springford bench pleading to cut him.
Let him go.
And they go out of bounds. McCutcheon, a little gamesmanship there. Pete turns in, faces him. It's a point. 19 seconds to go here. He stayed with his back to him. He knew he could not get the point, get retaken down. There's Dirk in on a shot, head outside double. McCutcheon got the heel to the butt. Nothing here, 10 seconds to go. He's got to hold on here.
Nice job by McCutcheon.
Nothing. Nice job by McCutcheon. Way to gut it out. Nugent a little bit surprised. Springport fans did not like that.
A really nice job by McCutcheon there, fighting off.
Yeah. Again, hats off to the freshman. Nugent coming out fearless.
Yeah, he pushed him.
We got Zach Engelhart, freshman from O&J. 2-11 on the season, 2-11 for his career. A little stop, but you're not sure why Kurt Weinberger's over at the table.
What we said about sportsmanship, we'll ask you guys to leave the next time. Okay.
Guess we had some comments come from the Springford side that Kurt Weinberger was not appreciative of. Went to the head table, had Timmy Lewis, the man, the myth, the legend that does all the timing and scoreboard, and there we go with a lat drop or hip throw, whatever you want to call it, and Mitch has got Engelhart in trouble.
Hunter Mitch, one of these wily veterans for Springford team.
Doesn't waste time. 17 seconds to give the Rams three. Here we go. 126 pounds. It's 24-9 score. We have Aiden Wren from the Wildcats. He's in the lineup tonight because Dan Mancini did not make weight. Talented freshman Dan Mancini. It's unfortunate. Wren's 0-6 on the season. 0-6 for his career.
Let's go back to Hunter Mitch last match real quick. Talk about him. We didn't have time. He was 25-5 coming in. He was 25-15 last year. Up now for Spring Ford is Jimmy Frank. He's coming in at 15-10. He was 24-19 last year. Both of these two guys are crafty veterans here for Spring Ford. They've been around the block and in the program for 3 or 4 years.
You know, it's no mistake either that they're back-to-back weights and they're having the success they have because they have each other in the room every day, which is, you know, you can't put a price on that. Aiden Wren here, the guy who came, has a ton of potential for the Wildcats. Just trying to find his way and put it together. He's still a young guy, just a sophomore, and he's working to find his way. And, you know, he has a chance in the lineup here, and he's a kid that doesn't give up. So, you know, we'll see how he does against Jimmy Frank tonight.
Yeah, it'd be nice if Hunter Mitch and Jimmy Frank can kind of crack the ice at regionals there, both regional qualifiers. Or sorry, Jimmy Frank didn't quite make regionals last year. But they're both looking to make a long run in the postseason as seniors.
And Frank's got him in trouble now. Got the bar in the wing and a half. And it is now all of a sudden a 24-15 match. You know, this is kind of what we expected these last two matches of Spring Ford putting some points on the board here. As we go to 132 pounds, we've got senior Stone Bisland. Comes with a record of 10-7. District qualifier last year, 27-26 for his career. Was fifth at the Conestoga Valley Holiday Tournament. Bisland with the shot. It's countered by Grenice, but Bisland then spins behind.
Oscar Grenice, Jr. from Springport, coming with a 5-8 record.
Bisland looking to go near side cradle right now. Grenice doing a good job of countering, getting back to his base. Stoney into his cradle ride right now. He's attacking the points. Got the back leg bulldog. He's trying to come across the face. He's got the far ankle. He's going to look to now start bending him back. We got a minute and 20 left here in the first period. Oh, he's got, if he could have hooked the leg in and he had it, he could have got back exposure, but now he's looking to run that head to the knee. Grenice doing all he can to counter right now. He's on the total defensive way to go here. And there he goes, back hooked. So he's trying to tilt. He doesn't have hips in, but he's still got a one count. Missing some of these guys in the O&J lineup. Solid wrestler that, you know, kind of had to wait his turn to see regular varsity action. And, you know, senior, nice roll through, cross-face cradle by Bisland. He's got him in trouble. He needs to get that low knee in his side, not hook this front knee. That's almost counterproductive by hooking that leg he already had locked up in the cradle. He kind of pulled the lock away, his own lock open. Runs the lead to 5-0, 25 seconds to go in the first period. He's going right back to the cradle. See if he hits the roll through again. No. Grenice not doing a hole on bomb. Has not come up off his base yet. And knee comes up. Now he's at that tight waist. He's going to look to Till. He's got the hip loaded. It's another one of those matches that, you know, on paper can go either way. Then, you know, see if now they're wrestling, what happens.
Stoney's a very unorthodox kid. He can throw his moves from every different which direction.
Yeah, he's not your cookie cutter O&J wrestler by any sense of imagination. He does. He's wide open style. So. Nice job attacking the ankle and his spin around. Keep Grenice from coming off his base. Now he's got the hip loaded again. See if he looks to go near side cheap tilt. Nice shot by Stoney coming around front. He's got the low arm trap. Let's see if he goes Turk to low leg. He's getting back now. He's got Grenice in some trouble. Grenice going to try and get that left arm through. Stoney hooks up now. If he comes off that leg there, he might be able to get out to the side and get a better opportunity. Just not a fan of hooking that leg in that situation. He's holding three back, so it'll be a major decision criteria after this as you come down on the halfway point of the match. Grenice can't do much more than bridge. Stoney's in good position. Now we go. Lets that one go. It's unfortunate, but he does get the three back as we did talk about.
8-0, 50 seconds to go here in the second period. Stoney's got to control this match pretty well.
He's elevating the wrong leg. Now he's got to get hips in. Nice job. He's getting some back there. Uh-oh. He got the two back. Make it 10-0, but I think I got reversed. He's coming out now. He's going to get the reverse back. Has to make it 12-2. There it is. 30 seconds to go in the second period.
You can see how he does some really nice things, and then he'll get sloppy every once in a while. He made up for it, came back. It's 12-2 now. 10 seconds to go.
He's the high-risk, high-reward wrestler that every team has. And like I say, goes for broke. And we'll see another guy kind of like that, Cole Meredith, coming up here, and maybe at 45 or 52. Stoney doesn't stop. He's been on his offense the whole time, to his credit. As he goes down here in the third period, and I will in the bet, if I was a betting man, he's not going to take his foot off the pedal. Just to say, he'll slip off it outside Grenice, and he gets his one escape. Minute 43 left in the match. He's up 13-2.
Oscar's fighting.
There's a shot attempt, high crotch shot attempt, head inside. Switch it off to now head inside single. Throw by Stoney, right to Grenice's back. He's got the lower arm trapped again. Let's see if he can get the pin this time. Stoney throws him out of bounds with authority there to the message. Ah, nice job. Grenice came in head hunting. Stoney.
Very nice shot
came
by
underneath.
Stoney.
He's got a lot of time to work for a tech fall here. He doesn't have to rush it. He's in on a head inside double. He switched off to single. He's going to look to swing to the side. 43 seconds to go. Takedown gives him the tech fall. Springfort coach pleading with Grenice to keep his hands down.
Every point's important here.
Exactly. Tony's in, there's Stoney. There he is.
Gotta
he's got it now.
Points.
He's going to go to the back.
There
he runs at half. Oh, missed out. There's Tech Ball at 5 minutes and 27 seconds. Makes it a 29-15 lead in favor of the Wildcats as we go into 138 pounds. Another one of our marquee matchups. We have Ryan Resnick from the O&J Roberts Wildcats. Junior, record 23-5, coming off his sophomore season. Time go 41-13, fifth at regionals, did not place at states, did qualify, 80-29 in his career, and ranked third in the region in our latest ranking, PAWrestling.com's latest rankings.
For Springfort, we got Matt Kreibel coming with a 16-4 record. He was 32-14 last year. He made it to states, did not place.
So again, two of the better wrestlers in the region, again, there. In neighboring high schools. We talked about the depth of the Pac-10 at certain weight classes.
Sure, Kreibel will have a good opportunity to hit the 100-win mark before the end of the season, sitting with a career record of 91-48.
Shot attempt by Kreibel. Is it Kreibel or Kreibel, Coach? I always thought it was Kreibel. Brother, family's wrestled for Springfort ahead of him. It's not a name.
Ask mom. If you want to know the answer to anything, ask mom. Mom knows.
Don't they all?
Yep.
Go out of bounds. 1:08 left in the first period. No score here. Both guys kind of feeling each other out. My eyes don't deceive me. I think Kriegel's rocking a mustache right now. Good for him. Maybe he wants in the mustache wars that Bordentown's got going on. Right now, Resnick with the far elbow, accompanied by the near side underhook. Kriegel trying to pinch those elbows together. He's taking package all in one. See if he's going to jack him up and step in and try and trip him. Not a good move or not a good scene for Resnick to be in, but definitely for Kriegel's offense.
Ryan Resnick's another good young kid. Solid in the classroom. Solid young man.
Oh, works beautiful
hard.
Spin behind.
Awesome
double
move by Resnick.
High double, tight waist. Beautiful. He's going to try and go cross face right now. Doing a good job on top here, not letting Kriegel escape.
8 seconds.
Good job. Smart by Resnick to climb up on top of 4 seconds to go. Instead of letting Kriegel get away. Short time here. See if Kriegel is able to get out. Tries the Granby. Nice step over by Resnick. Good first period. Great takedown by Resnick.
Again, if both of these kids stay at 138 for the postseason, it'll be, again, they'll see each other 3-4 weeks in a row. Be interesting to see how it plays out here in the postseason on the road to Hershey.
Yep. Fun time of the year. It's like Christmas for wrestling fans. District duels happening. For no, the league tournaments will be here. Resnick lets him up, and we are 2-1 here. 1:40 in left in the second period. Kriegel doing a lot of reach with that lead leg hands, leaving himself exposed there. Not sure if he's setting Resnick up for something, but.
You see a definite contrast in styles. You got the wild Stoney who wrestled previously. Here you have very, very fundamentally sound Ryan Resnick.
Very methodical in his approach. We hit the halfway point. Ooh, nice boot scoot attempt. Halfway point of the match. Creed was getting a lot of forward pressure, a lot of pushing on him. It was a great opportunity, great time to hit that scoot. A lot of action here so far. Just not a lot of points.
Looking for one of them to pull the trigger here.
Probably really isn't taking a shot yet. Here, Aaron Brown from the bench yelling at Kurt Weinberger. He should be getting a stalling warning. It's a little bit of wishful thinking on Coach Brown's part. Nice. A shot pick, knee pick, ankle pick attempt by Resnick. Kriegel quick to counter, though. 14 seconds to go here in the period. There's a caution. Kriegel trying to time the whistle. Gets his first caution of the match. Rewind under 10 seconds to go in the period.
Here's another one of these tight matches. You know that if you plan on winning a dual meet, you got to win these one-point matches, and this is going to be another big one here for both teams.
Yep. Nice hip whip attempt there by Resnick. Looks like he's going to get out front, get his one. There it is. 11 seconds into the period, he extends his lead to 3-1. Again, this is, you talked about, this is a must-win for Spring Ford here. If they're going to start to climb back into the match, they don't have many bullets left in the gun. And this would be a big one that they need. And Kreibel's still in the match. It's only takedown away. Is shot attempt by Resnick. Again, defended very well by Kreibel. Resnick, aside from that spin, high double, tight waist that he hit coming out of the tie-up, he hasn't really been able to generate a whole offense on his feet. And that's Kreibel's first shot attempt. That's a great thigh pry by Resnick. But it looks like he's not going to get any points here, unfortunately. Great job by Resnick. Again, he hit the boot scoot at the corner, at the edge of the mat. Didn't get any points. He hit that thigh pry there out of the front headlock and didn't get anything. And here we are, 50 seconds to go in the match, and Kreibel's still in it. Seconds to go here. Resnick not shutting it down, but knowing that he doesn't have to be on his offense right now. He's going to keep it right in the center of the mat. He's not going to let Kreibel push him around. Kreibel really not doing a whole lot either as far as shots. Ooh,
he's going to have to get going here. He's got 15 seconds.
Resnick missed a great opportunity to reshot. A lot of heavy clubbing out of Kreibel. Resnick takes him back to the middle of the mat. He doesn't have a stalling warning left. He can run basically the rest of the match. Better watch the back trip. Nice match.
Nice finish by Ryan Resnick there.
Both guys wrestle incredibly tough. And you know how many times we said it tonight, they're going to see each other again more than once. They're going to see each other Pac-10 tournament. Won't be surprised to see them in the district tournament against each other. We talked about the Go for Broke guys. Here's one for ONJ. We have Cole Meredith. He's just a freshman, 7-4, battled an injury earlier in the year, was in the lineup, was out of the lineup, has wrestled as high as 160. He's basically wrestling anywhere they've needed him. He's settling back into his weight. And we have...
Yeah, this is Jonathan Westlake from Spring Ford. Comes into the match with an 8-7 record. He was 15-14 last year. Got out of sectionals, did not place at the district match last year.
And there you had Cole Meredith trying to go front headlock into back trip. And just, you know, he's Westlake, the taller wrestler, had the leverage. Didn't get it, but there, Cole Meredith with the Grammy right to Westlake's back. And this is the type of kid he is. This could be devastating for Springport if he gets the pin. And Meredith, one of the talented freshmen in his freshman class for ONJ, and now he's got him locked up pretty tight. He's having trouble and a lot of time left. This is huge for ONJ if he can lock it up here. There it is. There's your fall at a minute one.
That's a nice win for the young freshman, Cole Meredith. I'm going to check after the match to make sure he did his homework for tomorrow.
Definitely.
Yeah.
I got to have a little homework club after the match.
A little bit of algebra. Got a test coming up.
Jeez, Coach, you told me you just gave a quiz yesterday. You're really...
Always testing them, you know?
All right, here we have the other McCutcheon brother. We have Ricky McCutcheon. 8-9 in the season, wrestling 45-52. Was 6th at Conestoga Valley over the holiday break, had a nice tournament. And again, you know, guy that freshman taking a few licks, but handed him out as well.
For Springport, this is Ben DiArcangelo. Comes in with an 8-8 record. He was 1-2 last year. He has a 9-10 career record. This is a nice young kid for Springport, plays football and a wrestler. One of these kids that's good on the mat, off the mat, great on the football field, do anything that you ask. Good high quality character kid here in the Spring Ford program.
Just did a nice shot passing hands, getting on the shot and taking down McCutcheon. Said this is a nice chop of the half. Almost got a reversal. A lot of movement on Bob McCutcheon again. McCutcheon, Meredith, and Mancini, who did not make weight tonight, that we talked about earlier.
He's in the doghouse a little bit, I think,
yeah,
right now.
Probably.
Young buck, he'll learn.
Yep. This is, again, a mistake that he made, and, hopefully learns from it. But this pretty large class of freshmen for Owen Jay, and these are three pretty talented guys that are, they're not replacing Galata, D'Orsanio, and Petroselli just yet, but they're probably the next big three, coming up out of this program, that Northchester program through the middle school. I had the privilege to coach the three of them last year in their eighth grade year, and all three had nice seasons, and it was no surprise that they're having the success that they're having right now at this level.
We should note that Spring Ford and O&J, both middle schools, wrestled yesterday. Both do have good middle school programs, got some good young wrestlers coming up through the ranks. Be very exciting to watch these kids grow. You've coached them. I've coached some of these older kids when they were younger. It's just neat to see them mature and kind of go through the programs and become quality young men.
Yeah, and that's what these programs are good at, churning out. We have about 2 seconds left in the period here, and Derek Hamsville will ride his 2-0 lead into the second. Derek Angelo deferred, and McCutcheon chooses the down position for the start of the second period. 38-15 here, in a 152-pound match.
What's tough this year in the area, you have Boyertown that's head and shoulders above everybody else right now. They're just at a whole different level. But you have schools like O&J, Spring Ford, Upper Darby's wrestling good this year. Downingtown East are just that second-tier teams. They're just really good quality teams. They're just not going to be able to handle the Boyertown or Council Rock South. They're both wrestling extremely well.
McCutcheon chopping down that half again, and there he is right in the reversal. Nice job. Makes it 4-3 here in the coming up on the midpoint of the match.
It's a nice job of the younger McCutcheon. Fighting.
Yep. We have, like you said, the top two teams are clear cut, Boyertown and Council Rock South, and then it's anyone's game to get those next two spots coming out of District 1 to go to state duels.
Yeah, it's going to be a battle this weekend. Be interesting to see how it plays out.
Said Boyertown and Spring Ford will square off Friday evening. O&J will score off with Council Rock South. They unfortunately both draw. Springford getting the one seed and Boyertown in quarterfinals. They're nice outside, head inside single. He comes up, lifts in, he breaks the hips down. He's in cover for two, and he ties the match at five with 34 seconds to go in the second period. Nice shot by McCutcheon. O&J drawing the two seed after their win over Rock North, avenging an earlier season loss. Safe to assume, don't want to count my chickens before they're hatched, but they'll both be in the consolation bracket after the quarterfinals on Friday evening. About 10 seconds to go. See if McCutcheon can ride him here. There he goes, gets him out of bounds. 8 seconds to go. He's really going to want to ride him here, keep him down, not give him any extra points. See what Derek Canzo's got up his sleeve to get out here in the end of the second period. See if he goes Grammy. Nope, stands up. O&J bench not happy with that.
Yeah, that's a young mistake there.
Derek Angelo's choice goes down in the third period. Last 2 minutes of the match here.
Yeah, Ben's a no-quit kid. He's gonna give you all he has all the time. It's going to be interesting how this match finishes here.
See if McCutcheon puts him. And there's the escape. Minute 44 left. Nice job using the 2-on-1, getting to the legs, but Derek Hans did a good job of countering. McCutcheon gave him up a little bit of weight. Weighed in at 45 today. doing the math, looking ahead, O&J does have the match sealed. They are going to win tonight, even if Springfield gets three pins. Springfield will not be able to overcome the deficit that they're facing right now. Ricky's tired. Ricky's tired. Let's go. 38 seconds to go. McCutcheon down two. He's in on a high single. See if he can keep him in bounds. And it looks like he's going to get it there. Nice job.
Ooh.
Now comes the task of riding him.
Again, the young freshman got up there before the whistle blew. He's got to learn to never quit.
All right. They're putting a lot of faith in this freshman here. He's grown up in front of our eyes. They put him on his feet, put him at 1 point deficit with 30 seconds to go. Hoping he's going to get the takedown to win the match for himself. 15 seconds going. He hasn't taken a shot yet. There he is in the same shot again. He's coming up with it. He's going to crack hip down again. He's going to circle to his left.
Got 5 seconds.
Nice job by both guys. Both guys wrestled very well. Derek Angel held on. Two young guys that are probably going to see each other again at some point in time.
Yeah, I think we'll be seeing those two young kids for the next couple years wrestle. Both got big hearts.
We've got Jason Zoller, a sophomore. 6-12 record coming out 164. The O&J Wildcats.
Senior Brett McGill for Springford, coming in with an 18-9 record.
O&J staff real high in Zoller, talking about how he's their most improved wrestler this season. He's doing a good job buying into the system. You know, taking his licks. He's a younger guy at a higher weight. Needs to put some muscle on to compete with these bigger guys, but he doesn't back down. He goes out and competes, and, you know, just only a confidence builder for him. Tell you, there's a McGill yesterday on the middle school team. I wonder if it's Brett's brother that was, you know, he's a hammer. Again, in that pipeline coming from that Springford youth program. Wondering if that's instead a brother coming up or a cousin. Had the opportunity to interview McGill after the Springford Boyertown duel, and you know what I took away from it was that he's a guy that comes through this program and waited till his senior year to have an opportunity to start on a regular basis. He's making the most of it. You know, he's having a nice senior campaign. He sat behind, name escapes me right now, Frankie Krause, I'm sorry, for several years. And, you know, it's no surprise Frankie Krause being he was a hammer in the lineup for Springford for a few years. He just couldn't crack it. Now he has his chance. You can see, you know, this guy put his time in, earned his spot, and he's again having a fine senior season.
Yeah, it's awesome to see. You know, you need those guys in your program. Again, if you want to have a competitive program year in and year out, you need kids like McGill. You know, fill your room out, they get a chance. He's taking advantage of his opportunity. You know, wrestlers are a different breed. It takes a lot to work out for 4 years and take that pounding. You know, you got to have a different mindset.
Yep.
And that, it's neat to see for a kid like that to work his butt off and to see it pay off now.
Yeah, I totally agree. You know, that's what has made Springford so good. They just have numbers, and you know, you see them coming in weigh-ins in some years, like 40 kids hit the scale in a night, and it's nice to see for the sport that people say at times is dying. You know, they come in with an army of kids. O&J's got over 30 kids in the room every day, and you know, just a testament to the program. You know, too many kids these days are too soon to quit because they're not starting. And you know, maybe I'm sure Springford has kids that do that, but they have more kids than not that stick with it and put the time in to, you know, wait their turn to be part of something special. No score in that first period, and McGill goes down, and a lot of movement here on bottom, and he comes out for the escape within the first 15 seconds of the second period. Again, Zoller's doing a good job battling. Just a sophomore wrestling the senior McGill. Zoller spent some time down at 52 early in the season. Nice strike, sucking him in for the front headlock, but Zoller's not out. He looks like he's going to get two here, but decides to fix his headgear instead of continuing to wrestle, and he could have had a takedown. Now he's going to come up high with this. Now he goes back to the Merkel. There's the two. You know, Zoller's really gave up an opportunity to score points there because he decided he wanted to play with his headgear. It's, you know, too many times you see that. I see it at the youth level. I see it at the middle school level, and you know, it's terrible when you see it at this high school level. Kids worry about their headgear. Just wrestle. Zoller's looking to come out the back door here. He's got to get a little bit more height, and guys got to take that leg off the head. Well, he lets McGill get the hips in and pound on him, and he breaks his base down. He's not having it. He's back up. He's got to pop his head out. Got locking hands here by McGill, so we've got a free move here for Zoller's chance to come out.
Take
turns
advantage
into him.
Of it.
He's got to get that arm free. Better watch the Peterson here. He's got to get pressure to that head. He wants to stop it. McGill's got to let him. Gotta let him wrestle back into him, get that weight back into him, not stretch him out like that. Good shot by Zollers. Gets the escape, makes it a 3-2 match. Waved off the locking hands, realized he was locked through the crotch, not over the body. Very self-aware by Kurt Weinberger, one of the, you know, again, lucky to have him here tonight, one of the better officials in District 1, if not all of the state. We end the second period. 3-1 lead for Zollers. Hanging tough here with the senior. Again, like I said, talked about no quitting this kid. McGill to the 2-on-1, looking to suck him back into a tilt. Had the hip loaded for a second. He's back to 2-on-1, see if he goes tilt the other side or if he's going to try and reinforce that bar. He's trying to go hazard tilt. Zoller's doing a good job trying to get his hips down. He's got to get forward pressure and push away. A one count of one by Kurt Weinberger, but that's it. Zoller's can't give that 2-on-1 again. A chop, you see he's trying to get forward pressure, chop that arm in, and he just has done it again. See if he goes back to that hazard tilt. Now he does not have any more, but he's maybe trying to slip a bar in. He's up over the front. Zollers has gotten his hands free, but McGill using that forward pressure gets him broken down.
And Zollers has about a minute to work here. He's down two.
He's to his feet. See if he can turn in, get one. There he is. He's got the one. He broke it.
All right, let's see if the young buck can make something happen here. Looks a little winded.
And this is what they like about him. They like to, there's no quitting him. And you see, don't be surprised if he turns up the pressure here. McGill looks a little winded. He didn't look winded like this when I saw him last week against Boyertown.
Seconds here.
Zoller's trying to work the 2-on-1, trying to shrug it by, get a shot in, but again, McGill's just holding on, tying him up, doing a nice job. 2 seconds to go. Again, great match by McGill. Runs his record to 19-9 on the season. Get ready to go to 170 pounds. Mickey Cohn for the O&J Roberts Wildcats. Cohn, a senior, comes in with a record 12-11. Was 12-13 last year. District qualifier, 27-32 for his career. This season saw him place fifth at the Conestoga Valley Christmas tournament.
For Springfield, coming up will be Stephen Rice. Comes in with a 25-3 record. Pretty solid wrestler. He was 34-15 last year. He made it to states. Did not place. He has a 74-26 lifetime record. Another good, awesome, solid kid in the Springfield football and wrestling programs. Looking to make another run to states this year.
Bit injured as of late. Rumors got a possible broken finger. Something to effect. Looks like he's got one taped on his left hand.
A little bit of a hand injury. He'll be all right. He's a tough kid.
Lost a tough match to Elijah Jones from Boyertown last week. Bit of an upset. Nice shrug right into the takedown for two. Cone stands right back up. Maybe caught Cone a little bit off guard there. Head inside single on the far elbow is Rice. Again, Cone's another guy who's going to battle for OJ.
Rice is a triplet. Did you know that?
I did not.
Yes, he's the ugliest of the three.
I'm sure he would debate that. Nice ankle pick attempt for Rice right into the front headlock. Drops off to the single. He's got Cone in trouble here. He's in again there too. Pullman. Nice job throwing it by. Oh, Mickey doing a good job. He gets that far ankle though. Mickey's got dangled it out there for him. There's your two.
Nice job by Steve there. Again, I'm just joking. He's a handsome man. All three boys, good boys, hardworking kids.
Rice the only wrestler of the three?
Yeah. His one other brother played football for us. He was an O&D lineman. The other brother was our film guy for the football team.
Nice head inside double cone. A little throw by. And nothing.
Steve was the defensive player of the year for the Pac-10 this year. Had an awesome year playing linebacker for Springfield.
Is he wrestling or playing football in college or neither?
He's a smart kid. He was looking at like small D3 schools like Franklin and Marshall possibly. Your Sinus, schools like that. Wasn't quite sure if he was just going to play football or just wrestle or possibly do both. So he's keeping the options open, I believe.
5 seconds there. Shrug attempt, and he's got Cone. Cone going to try and throw a headlock. Rice too quick for it. Too good. Not going to fall for that. Rice already looking better than he did last week against Elijah Jones. I'm not sure if the hand was an issue last week or, give credit to Jones that he wrestled a good match against Rice.
Yeah, he did wrestle a really good match.
Sit-out attempt by Mickey Cone. Folks, keep in mind, tomorrow, Thursday, February 4th, the new rankings are going to come out.
Oh, those rankers, they get a lot of flack, don't they?
Who?
Hot item on the forum there.
I know a few of them. And they,
some pressure.
Not a job I'd like to have. You make your picks, and you get a ton of flack for it. But
it's tough. They do a good job. They obviously can't see every kid wrestle every match. You know, I think they do a pretty awesome job, though.
You're going to see a shakeup probably at 106 with Wild now winning again. You know, he was honorable mention or fifth last time. He's definitely going to move up. We'll see if he jumps right to number one. You know, again, but Meredith with a big win. You know, we'll see what happens if maybe the guys kind of just stay the same in position as far as positions and just jockey for, their spots, per se. There we have the escape by Rice, 7 seconds into the period. It's a little bit too quick for Mickey.
Yeah, Rice is a pretty solid wrestler, you know. Mickey's got his hands full here.
Again, Rice in another shot. It's been all over Cone. What Rice has done is his offense has just been his best defense. He has not let Mickey Cone get comfortable at all. And you know, it's led to the 7-2 lead, and, you know, we're not done seeing Rice. I think Rice is going to start to pour it on him now. He's going to go hunting for some bonus points for his team in the last match of the evening.
Yeah, Rice is another one of those kids that's got no quit. He's got one speed. It's full speed. Just an awesome kid to have, again, to be part of your program. Really sets the tone and sets a good example for the younger kids coming up through.
I was at home wondering why that wasn't a takedown. It's because Mickey Cohen came down out of bounds, and so did Rice. Rice had to keep two posts in bounds, and he didn't keep any because he chased behind Cohen. There's a shot attempt by Cohen, but Rice was quick to defend it.
Looks like the Cats are pretty much going to go to 5-1 here and take a hold of second place in the Pac-10. Springfield will most likely end up taking third with a 7-2 record, I believe, will end up with. Cats got a handful of dual meets yet, though, to go through.
They have the, not surprisingly tough. I mean, it was no mistake that Pottstown was having a nice season in their matchup nightmare for some teams. There's Rice in another double leg takedown. Circle Sips gets it for a 9-2 lead with 40 seconds going to second period. Pottstown, like I said, the matchup nightmare. They have a bunch of solid kids, and if they hit, you know, the right matchups, it could be a problem for anyone on any given night. Sands, Boyertown. Boyertown is so deep, but you know, the Penny Packers, the Wise, you have Jimmy Mazzy's having a nice season. William Gephardt is a tough kid. You know, they have guys, and they don't have a whole lot of depth, but they have kids that go out and scrap, and they have kids that go out and wrestle. So O&J travels to Pottstown next Tuesday night, where the middle school, and I think they wrestle, actually they go to Pottsgrove first for a makeup,
yes,
and then they go to Pottstown after that. They're going to the Pottstown tour. There's a sit-out attempt by Conan against Escape with 7 seconds going to period, making a 9-3 match. And they will wrestle the nightcap against Pottstown, and the O&J middle school will wrestle Pottstown's middle school simultaneously during the varsity match. That rivalry, long-standing rivalry between the two schools, Pottstown and O&J.
Mickey Cohn not giving up here. It's 9-3. Start of the third period.
Talk about unorthodox wrestlers. I would throw Mickey into that mix.
Absolutely.
You know, he's a kid that he's not going to set the world on fire, but if you make a mistake, he's going to make you pay for it. So Rice has to be on his toes here to not make any mistakes, because Mickey has been around for years, coming through youth wrestling freestyle. He puts a lot of time in, so he's not new to this by any sense of imagination. Takedown attempt, or I'm sorry, escape by Rice, make it 10-3. Takedown puts him into that major decision criteria.
Springford's next match again is this Friday, 7:30 at Upper Dublin. O&J wrestles Council Rock South at 6, I'm sorry. They both wrestle at 6 o'clock this Friday. Both are going to have their hands full, I believe.
Yes.
Again, with Boyertown and Council Rock South, I think.
They're in their double leg takedown by Rice to make it 12-3 with 1:25 left in the third period. Both teams, like I said, daunting tasks in the quarters, but it's double elimination from here on out. They had to win that first one to get to where they're at.
Yeah, I think O&J's got a good chance to fight back there to get to that third, fourth place match.
PAWrestling.com will be there this Friday and Saturday. We'll be covering Downtown East and Penridge in one of the quarterfinals. And we will get one of the semis after that. We have maybe the Downtown East Penridge winner against the O&J Council Rock South winner as the other semifinal, or the semifinal that we'll cover. And then we'll be able to cover some consolation match on Saturday before we hit the final up Saturday evening, AAA final, not AA final, which all things point that it's going to be a big time showdown between Boyertown and Rock South. On paper, Coach, I got it 7-7, but I don't know. It's going to come down to bonus points.
I think Boyertown's got a little bit of an edge.
I'd like to say maybe a few more bullets in the gun. 30 seconds here. 12-3 lead for Rice.
Hopefully this can give the Wildcats a little bit of momentum. Carry that into the weekend possibly. Finish strong as a team.
Looks like we're going to finish here, and Rice is going to get the major decision to make it 38-25. 13-point win for the Wildcats. If it ends the way with the last 10 seconds here in the match. And there you have it. 38-25, your final score here in Bucktown as O&J on their home mat takes care of business, defeats Springford. So those teams wait to line up here. Chuck, did it go how you expected it?
It was fun. It went fast. It's quick. I enjoyed it. Hopefully we can do it again.
Final score
sometime soon.
28,
good luck to you the rest of the way here.
Thank you.
Announcing and covering the matches. You guys do an awesome job.
38-25.
Just keep it up. Keep giving wrestling a good name. Keep promoting it.
Yep, definitely appreciate you sitting with us tonight and taking the time out of your evening to share a little knowledge with us and talk some of the Springford guys and some of the O&J guys. You have a very unique, interesting perspective. Any guys that stick out to you tonight that opened your eyes with their performance?
Ryan Resnick, that Kriegel match was a really good one. Again, it came down there. A couple one-point matches either way could have made that a little bit tighter than it was. They were just hard-fought both ways. Both teams, again, quality programs with quality coaches. There's Mr. Rice giving us a little notice there. Again, I'm really looking forward to watching both these teams wrestle into the postseason.
Yeah, no, I just think that the tone set by O&J with the three pins out the chute and then the decision by and put them up 24-0, you know, just that alone, it would have been 24-25. They didn't wrestle in a match, so it just shows that it was a 13-point win, but, you know, it wasn't really that close of a match. I don't think O&J ever felt threatened. They didn't have their freshman phenom, Dan Mancini, in the lineup.
Correct.
So, in all intents and purposes, quite possibly could have been even worse.
Sure. O&J's deeper than them. And with Mancini in there, you're right. It would have been a little bit more spread out, probably.
So, as we talked about, on to the next match, we have Boyertown and Springford in a rematch. And we're going to go O&J Rock South on Friday. Both teams are going to get after it. So, folks, stay tuned. As always, any feedback, please post to the forum, pawrestling.com. Thank Chuck Nestle for sitting with us tonight. Much appreciated.
Yeah, again, take it easy on the new guy with the forum.
Yeah.
Don't pick on me too much.
I don't think they will. Thanks, Kurt Weinberger, O&J Roberts, for having us. Ralph Gretz, Dr. Richard Marchini, Steve DiRaplo, Mike Brilla, Tim Gerber, Ty Willman, Aaron Brown, Howie Sage, so for hosting us, and of course Mike Leister, the man behind the scenes that does all the work, gets all the this website up and running, and it's just super impressive, and we're lucky to have a guy that is such a resource to District 1 and the state in what he does. So with that said, we're going to sign off here. It's Joe Youngblood with Chuck Nestle, Mike Leister. Everyone have a good night. Look forward to seeing you and you guys tune in for District Duels. Take care. Good night.